Hello?
Yeah.
No, I won't finish the process. Okay, so before I begin, I just want to make some comments about what we just heard, because my speech is going to be very, very similar. There's going to be some agreement, strong agreement, and there's going to be some strong disagreement. I think the biggest disagreement we would have is the creation of autonomous regions or zones in Syria, and that the fences make good neighbors. I think that fences inside the same country should be torn down. You never hear about Balkanizing the United States with the Germanic regions and the South American regions or the African towns, or we never hear about building a wall around Chinatown or any putting Chinese Australians somewhere and white Australians somewhere, because that would be unheard of. But for some reason we can openly talk about that when it comes to the Middle East, because imperialism and hegemony is trying to exploit these differences amongst people. And I do agree that the minorities and the language and history needs to be secured. And I do agree that labeling the Syrian state an Arab state is a problem. However, that doesn't mean that we should then label every single region of Syria such and such a race or ethnicity or religion, because it just creates an opportunity for imperial powers to use those divisions against us. On your graph, I was very interested to see in the list of people who are Syrian, Somalians and Iraqis were listed. However, what we need to be careful about is a lot of these statistics, they are designed to create this idea that Syria is not a homogenous entity and needs to be broken up. Somalians inside Syria have been there since the 90s, but as refugees. Palestinians as refugees since the 60s. Iraqis, maybe I mentioned them, as refugees. These are not citizens. And in fact, the majority of Kurds in Syria before 2011, where Bashar was pressured into handing citizenship, were considered refugees. And for that reason, if you have refugees in your country, you don't necessarily want them to continue speaking their language. You would like them to assimilate to your own language. And finally, before I begin, on the people of Aram, the Arameans and Assyria, they do have a big link and a big history. Syria got its name from Assyria. It used to be called Aram. And Aramaic-speaking people in Ma'lula, they are both Muslim and Christian. But the thing about the labeling of Syria as Arab, really that is a product of Ba'athism. It's a product of Arabization that came from the Arab invasion. And right, when it comes right down to it, the original ethnicity of the majority of the Syrians is Aramaic, not Arabic. And with that comes the fact that, the reason why Arab was pushed so hard was because of these outside pressures to divide the country. And at the time when Syria was just becoming a nation state, they needed some kind of a unified front, and Arabism won out. There was actually other discussions at the time of what the Syrian identity should be, and Arab wasn't the only one. There was also just the Syrian identity under the SSNP. With that, I'm going to begin talking about a very similar subject with the ethnic cleansing and Balkanization of Iraq and Syria. I'll try to truncate it. This is something we spoke about just now, Syria, Assyria, 1,000 years ago. There was also Armenia. And I'd like to just see where Armenia and Assyria are standing right here. And I'd like you to now think about where the Kurdish region is and where it lies, because it's lying exactly where, when you see the bigger map, I'll get to that. For those who haven't been here this morning, I spoke in depth about Sykes-Picot and how the French were using sectarian divisions in Syria to try to divide people with only limited success. Only, for example, Lebanon was divided and Hatay province was given to Turkey. The rest of Syria became unified. So when we're talking about Balkanization now, we're talking about Sykes-Picot version 2, the attempt to divide Syria further. And the only difference from these two maps is the fact that we have this Kurdish sector here, which wasn't there before. And the narrative that is pushed in the media is that Kurds don't have a state because Sykes-Picot forgot about them, and their land and nation was stolen from them, just as the land and nation of the Palestinians were stolen. And the problem with that narrative is that what land are they talking about exactly? Because the regions where the so-called Kurdish state is planned was Armenia, Assyria, and Syria. It was never a Kurdistan. There's never been a Kurdistan. So there's no, you can't really talk about a nation being stolen when there wasn't a nation there to begin with. In fact, there were other nations there. And it comes down to the question, what makes a nation? Does every sect, every ethnicity, just by being a different ethnicity alone, have that right to create a nation? And what location would that state be? Who would it be on the land of another population? So, and should we continue dividing people like that, or have we moved past such nation states? And you know, again, in this region where the Kurdish state is drawn, used to be for the last 5,000 years ago, as history shows, used to be Assyria, and of course Syria has an ancient Assyrian wall. And so the question is, where did the Kurds come from? Why are they there? If they didn't have a history and a nation there, why are they there in such high numbers? Well, you know, this is sometimes taken as very offensive, but there's no offense in something that is a respectable lifestyle. And the fact is that Kurds are Iranian nomads. They speak a dialect very similar to Iranian. They originate from Iran, and the word Kurd is actually originated from the word Kurt, which means Iranian nomad. And many of the Kurds still live these nomadic lifestyles in the mountains where they would tend sheep and goats. And there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. There's many beautiful nomadic cultures, and they should be surviving. But you know, the problem is that you don't hear about Bedouins and Gypsies talking about creating your own states, because they intrinsically know themselves to be nomadic, so they don't believe in borders, and they move around. And to be nomadic and then to suddenly say, you know, I now want a state on every piece of land that I've stepped on, is kind of hypocritical. Because in one way you're saying, I do not respect these borders, they are not real borders, and I can cross them. And at the same time, you want to draw your own borders. So how, you know, did the movement of Kurds outside of Iran move? Well, you can actually see by the population distribution maps how they mostly were concentrated in the northwest region of Iran and slowly went out following the rivers into Turkey and Iraq, and were more sparsely distributed into Syria and its surroundings. And in fact, the time where they became the majority in these regions was right after the Armenian and Assyrian genocide, where Ataturk actually got the help of Kurdish nomads to slaughter Armenians and Assyrians with the promise that they would have the houses of the Assyrians and Armenians and possibly their land. And the reason why it's important to mention this is because you always hear the same narratives that the Kurdish people have been victimized all the time. And of course, we hear that same narrative when it comes to Israel. The Jewish people are always victims, and hence they deserve a state. The Kurdish people are always victimized by everyone, and hence they deserve a state. But really, if you look at history, you know, they have been not always the victim. And the people who have been victimized are now being victimized again by the same narratives. So after the Armenian genocide, Ataturk actually betrayed the Kurds, and instead of granting them autonomy, he denied them autonomy, and when they fought for it, he fought them back. And since the 1920s, there were several waves of Kurdish refugees coming into Syria, every time there was a failed uprising against the Turks. And in fact, the leader of the PKK, Öcalan, himself admitted that the majority of Kurds in northwest Syria were actually refugees from Turkey and weren't originally Syrian. And so to talk about them, to talk about this portion of the population having like some say in Syria's becoming federalized is kind of very strange. So because especially since the numbers of Kurds inside Syria are 1.6 to 2.3 million, the very different assessments, the problem is that this population number is very fluid, especially since the war started. Many Kurds that were living in Syria went either back to Iraq or Turkey. In fact, the number estimated to be 420,000 Kurds are now in Iraq and Turkey that were originally in Syria because of ISIS. So these population numbers are fluid, but at the end of the day, the majority of the Syrian population is not Kurdish. In fact, you know, out of 22 million people, you have 1.6 to 2.3 million people. And so to grant those individuals a piece of land that would be providing water and food for the majority of the Syrian people is a form of genocide. And the thing about it is, you know, when we talk about, oh, the national, like, it's sold as a nationalist cause. The Rojava, the West Kurdistan, is sold as a nationalist cause. However, this Rojava doesn't have defined borders. It doesn't, there's no one Rojava that everybody agrees on. Because some believe it's everything beyond the Euphrates. Some believe it's just that little section of Hasafeh up there. Some believe it's the entirety of the north, including Aleppo, which has been in Syria's history for 13,000 years. And as you can see here, this is taking up about maybe 30% of Syria for 1.2 million people. And this is probably why the PYD and the YPG have to sell an ethnocentric state as a you know, a place where lots of minorities can live in unity, because they can't possibly just sell it as an ethnocentric state by itself, because they are not a majority in the areas that they claim to be their land. They are only a plurality in some of the regions, which means that they are the biggest minority, but not a majority by themselves. And if you look at down here, you can see the distribution of Kurds in the gray, that the population centers are not contiguous. It means they're not connected. And if you look at it as a big map of where the concentrations are, you'll see that the parts that have entered Syria are not the main concentration of where the Kurdish population is. And yet the media is really only talking about creating, you know, a Kurdistan in Iraq and Syria, even though Syria has 1.6 to 2.2 million Kurds, while Turkey has 15 million. And this is because it's in the context of imperialism that we have to discuss this. So again, since that Kurds are not a majority in the areas they're trying to annex, and they're not, they don't have contiguous population centers, what's going to result is ethnic cleansing. Because the areas where they were not connected, as was in this area here, in Mendish, they are trying to connect these areas up. And what happened in Mendish, of course, was the removal of the Arab population there. So in spite of the fact of having a minority population, they have a lot of military strength because the United States is behind them. And they also have the Peshmerga and the PKK who can cross the porous Syrian, Turkish, and Syrian-Iraqi border. So they have a lot of manpower in spite of having a limited population. And so they can take over swaths of Syrian land in spite of being such a tiny minority. So I think the previous speaker spoke a lot about the ethnic cleansing, but the thing about it is, you know, it's not just what they do. The leader of the PYD, Saleh Muslim, said in an interview on air that those Arabs who have been brought to Kurdish areas will have to be expelled. So he's actually stated on record that his intention to remove Arabs from what are designated Kurdish areas or, you know, ethnocentric Kurdish states. And in fact, not only has he said this, he's done this, he's burned and razed entire Arab villages to the ground. And this is something you don't really hear about in media. And the intention is that those Arab populations are not allowed to return. And the excuse for that is often ISIS. And of course, what was spoken about a lot was the ethnic cleansing of Assyrians. And this is not just happening in Syria, it's happening in Iraq. You have the KRG who are bulldozing Assyrian properties in the same way that Israel bulldozes Palestinian farms. And as we've spoken about before, you know, the KRG and YPG have introduced laws to confiscate people's lands. I'm not sure how much of this clip I can play because we're short on time. But the Assyrian organized a protest about their land being confiscated by the Kurdish regional government. But it was actually blocked by the Kurdish regional government. This is something that we don't hear about in the media. And just to save time, I'm just gonna move on. So again, we were spoken about in the speaker's speech, the trend is that the YPG and the Peshmerga, even though they are opposite sides of the spectrum, are pushing the same strategy. They come to other militia groups and they say either you say that you're 100% with us and you want Rojava or you want Kurdistan, or you lay down your arms, because if you don't lay down your arms, we will fight you. But if you do lay down your arms, we will take on the responsibility of protecting you against ISIS. But what actually happens is when ISIS does come, the Peshmerga have cut and run and abandoned these disarmed people to ISIS. In Sinjar, Iraq, the Assyrians and the Yazidis were kidnapped by ISIS. Both in 2014 this happened, in 2016 it's happening again. They disarm these groups and then they leave them for ISIS to wipe out. And we've already spoken about Syrian leaders being assassinated because they, you know, maybe gave trouble to the YPG of not disarming. And it's happened in the Kabul. So ISIS, in fact, has been instrumental to the Balkanization of strategy and agenda in Syria. It has allowed for the ethnic cleansing of these minorities, and it has allowed to be used as an enzyme to get rid of any group that doesn't agree with a Kurdish state. And you know, the fact that the ISIS is mostly in the Kurdish regions, and we always hear about Kurds fighting ISIS, isn't a coincidence, because as a matter of fact, the Kurds themselves are split. In fact, half the Kurds are ISIS, half the Kurds are joining ISIS, and the other half are fighting them. So this is why there's so much ISIS inside the Kurdish region. So what's happening is not just ethnic cleansing, but it's also the destruction of history, cultural appropriation, in its true sense of the word, not in the new SJW sense of the word. Because the Kurdish nationalists or separatists have no historical artifact linking them to the land that they claim is historically theirs, they either are stealing other people's history or destroying artifacts that are there. So if you have a look at this line right here, it says, Kurdistan, cradle of civilization, when in reality the antiques are all Assyrians' cradle of civilization. And then you have, this is the Kurdish flag vandalized onto some Assyrian artifacts. And again, you know, ISIS has played a part in destroying Syrian and Assyrian history. This is about destroying our history in order to dissolve the existence of the state and the existence of the identity of Syria and the people. And, you know, I hear a lot of arguments when you bring this up to people, and I know this is just going to be, it's not a good reference because it's just conversations I've had with people, but when I bring this up to Kurdish people, like, well, you know, you claim this land to be only yours and yours alone and everyone else is an invader, but in reality, history shows, artifacts show that historically, this has not always been your land. What they would say in response to that, well, you know, the Persian and Median Empire invaded Assyria, took over that land, and hence we're entitled to it. Or they will say that Assyrians don't actually exist, they're just Christian Arabs. Or they'll say that, you're just a Kurd-hating Arab, even though I don't identify as Arab. But this is the kind of racism, they accuse you of racism. This is the kind of terminology you hear a lot whenever you oppose the state of Israel. They just throw words like you're an anti-Semite, you're a racist, you hate Jews, the same way that you would have, you hate Kurds, you just hate Kurds thrown at you. And it's this victim complex, this victim like entitlement complex. And in fact, this is one of the reasons why Israel really wants a Kurdish state. They have, you know, a very common history about them. They both were nomadic in the sense, if you consider that Jews were lost in the desert, although, you know, Jews all over the world have had their own individual countries, and Jews is a religion, not just an ethnicity. But the Zionists, they were hell-bent on creating an ethnocentric state for a specific ethnicity, even though that is going to ethnically cleanse the original inhabitants of that land. And they often deny history, they often deny the existence of Palestine was over there. They say that Sykes-Picot borders are all fake and artificial, but for some reason, the borders that they have drawn are not artificial. So, again, they use terrorism, they use cultural appropriation the same way, and ironically, the most ironic part is this Kurdish struggle is painted as a nationalist struggle a la Palestine for people trying to self-determination, when in reality it's the exact opposite, and we're witnessing everybody smiling and nodding to the creation of a second Israel. Even from the left, people are cheering it on. Even from people who fight Israel every day, they come and carry the Kurdish flag. And it's complete irony, because it's like history repeating, only nobody's any smarter. So finally, you know, why? What is the imperial thing about this? Because obviously the minorities and the specific ethnocentric chauvinists are going to want their own states. But what's the imperial agenda behind this? Well, you could talk about Israel's Ode du Nord plan in 1982, which discussed dividing the Middle East into micromanageable mini-states and have them fight each other perpetually, so that Israel can not only be easily to control them and defend itself, but to eventually expand. And the expansion part of it maybe is in something that seems ridiculous now, but perhaps something that they still feel could happen far into the future. Because if you notice, the borders of the imperialists are trying to draw for this potential Rojava is always west of the Euphrates, because everything east of the Euphrates is considered part of Greater Israel. And of course, you can also discuss the 5,000-year-old history between Israel, Syria, and Assyria, and the vengeful nature that might exist in some people's minds about the Assyrian people, because, of course, Assyria went into Judea. So these 5,000-year-old wars are continuing. That's the interesting thing. These are considerations that happened such a long time ago. They still affect today. But what does the U.S. get out of it? Well, the U.S. is going to get pipelines, it's going to get client states, it's going to get divided states, and again, if you were to consider to create autonomous regions for every single tiny minority in Syria, you would have maybe 100 tiny states. And that's going to be easily destroyed and controlled by people who just want to steal Syria's resources and control the world. So that's what I have to say about that.